women. Murdered or missing. In Canada. A haunting national disgrace with no solution in sight.
No solution. Missing or murdered Indigenous women.
Brutally killed and buried in a farmer's field by a man she met on a dating site in 2016.
He stabbed her 11 times, slit her throat, smashed her skull, and broke her femur before burying her in a shallow grave east of Winnipeg.
Missing or murdered Indigenous women. Her daughter was murdered in her home in Calgary, and she was led to believe there would be a click of rats. 13 years later, no one has been charged.
Missing or murdered Indigenous women. Family says the pain only grows and has caused them to lose relationships and motivation in life. Please now.
Good evening, my beautiful crime family. I hope everybody's having an awesome Sunday. I didn't start out the day too good. I wasn't feeling so hot and still not quite there, but feeling a little better. I want to say hi to my crime family before I start getting into this. So, yeah. Hey, Crime Spy, good to see ya. And Joey, my brother, good to see you. And Angela, good to see you. Wild Child, good to see you. Elizabeth, good to see you. Moonflower Lass, my girl, good to see you. This is a late goal here today. I didn't even know. I 7 minutes ahead of... I had 7 minutes to get ready for this. So, yeah. Let me see here. I'm having some problems because there's a program that keeps trying to run on me. Nikki, good to see you. Ty Knotts, good to see you. Lila, good to see you. Amy, good to see you. Debbie Gazzardo, my girl, good to see you. And I can't even see who this one is. It's... I don't know what's going on there. Let me see if I show it. Oh, a moonflower. Okay. It wasn't shown on this end. Good to see all of you. This is going to be, I don't like getting into a lot of things, but this really needs to be talked about. And Elizabeth, good to see you. Lisa, good to see you. You know, my beautiful family. And you know, I try creating a really nice family here where we all, you know, get along at least somewhat, you know. We're all going to have different opinions. And, but for the most part, this is a beautiful, beautiful family here. And I appreciate all of you and I love you all very much. And not just the chatters, but the people that just watch. And the replay crew and everybody. It's just an amazing family we have here. And everybody that comes here always says that same thing. And tonight I'm going to get into something a little different. The gal that has this channel is from Minnesota. So, of course, I'm going to like her, right? But she's getting into the Native women that are missing. And, you know, she works with MMIW. And it's a good channel. And this case bothers me. And I think by the end of the video, you'll see why. And I do have a treat for you. After this video, I'm going to show an all-Native band that I know that are friends of mine, Jimmy Goodwin and Buck Jourdain, and Eric Reed is a really good friend of mine, and Tommy Buckinaga, the lead singer, a very good friend that he lost a son. He was there for me when I lost my son. And he lost his son, and he couldn't handle it and ended up taking his life. And he I got a video of him with us on stage too. He came up. You know, he came up on stage with us a few times. He played Judas in a very good production of Jesus Christ Superstar. And he bought my mom and I tickets, front row tickets, so we could see it front row. And it was magnificent. And after my son was murdered, he came and got me, and he took me out hunting, partridge hunting, and just talked to me. And I feel really bad because he was out of state when he took his life, and I wasn't there for him. And anyway, I'm going to play a video of him and his band called The Damnedest Thing when this video is over with. So this, okay, this is called The Mysterious Death of Olivia Lone Bear. And I'll tell you the channel here in a second. It's Monsters of the Midwest. And this gal is from Minnesota. So she's from my home state. And this is what I'm saying, you know. This has been a month, and she's only got 823 views on it. And this is what... more attention has... Hold on a second here. By the time this video is done, you'll understand why I get...
In the fall of 20...
why I get so upset over things. Here, I'm going to put this link so my mods have it here. Hi, Leslie and Billy. Good to see you too. Anyway, I'm going to let this play out, and you're going to see why I get so upset with what's going on, because it isn't just... it's everybody from tribal police to FBI to regular law enforcement, the sheriffs. It's just, it needs to come to an end, and it needs, people need to step up to the damn plate. Anyway, The Mysterious Death of Olivia Lone Bear.
2017, a North Dakota woman left a bar after hanging out with friends. She was never seen alive again. Almost a year later, her truck was discovered in a lake. Her body was buckled into the passenger seat, which indicated she did not go in the lake on her own. What caused the very mysterious death of Olivia Lone Bear? Hi, everyone. My name's Anne, but I also go by my nickname, Mimi. I like to focus on Midwest true crime because I'm a Minnesota farmer's daughter. Today, we're going to go to North Dakota and talk about the very mysterious death of Olivia Lone Bear, which is still unsolved to this day. I think most true crime junkies are familiar with the MMIW movement, which focuses on missing and murdered Indigenous women. This is one of those cases. Olivia is just one of hundreds of Native women who go missing or get murdered, and their cases just don't get a lot of coverage. And I don't mean just from YouTubers. I mean even from other forms of social media or in the news. They don't even get proper attention from law enforcement. And in this case in particular, to get any kind of authority to do anything was almost like pulling hairs. And it shouldn't be that way. Let's start by learning a little bit more about the beautiful woman who was Olivia Lone Bear. Olivia was born on October 11, 1985 in North Dakota to Tex Lone Bear and Irish Sherman Forebear. She was a member of the three affiliated tribes, which is also known as the Mandan, Haidatsa, and Irokara Nation, or MHA Nation. And I strongly apologize if I pronounced any of that incorrectly. Olivia was a free spirit and outgoing, very sociable. She loved to be outdoors during the summer and was always up for an adventure. She loved to spend time with family and friends and play poker, golf, go to concerts. And like I said, she was beautiful. Look at her. She was a beautiful woman. Olivia attended school in North Dakota until her junior year of high school when she moved to Wellpinit, Washington. She was active in school sports and played basketball, volleyball, and participated in cross country. Olivia became pregnant while she was still in high school and gave birth to a daughter in 2003. She finished her schooling through independent studies. In 2005, Olivia became mom for a second time when she gave birth to a little boy she named Caleb. Tragically, however, he passed away when he was 8 months old. I didn't see anything that said how he passed away, but obviously this was devastating. In 2009, Olivia moved back to North Dakota to be closer to her family. She had a very close relationship with her father and moved in with him in Newtown. This was a small town and has a population of around 2,500. Both North and South Dakota are kind of split down the middle by the Missouri River. The east sides are very flat, plains. Once you cross the Missouri River and head west, there's river bluffs, rolling hills. There's more wildlife. That part of North Dakota has some badlands that are very gorgeous, and the Theodore Roosevelt National Park is in that area. It's quiet country life where you don't think anything bad is going to happen. Newtown is on the Fort Berthold Reservation. This was home to Olivia's tribe, the MHA Nation. The reservation consists of almost 1 million acres, so a very vast land. Olivia gave birth to 4 more children. She was a proud mom and tried to give her children the best life she could. Olivia found work as a games dealer at the Four Bears Casino and also worked with the Edgewater Golf Course and Legion. According to someone who spoke to High Country News, Olivia also once worked as a waitress for the Ranchman's Steakhouse. The person who spoke with High Country News said she was a waitress who worked there. She claims the steakhouse fired Olivia after the wife of an ex-boyfriend came into the steakhouse and confronted Olivia. She apparently beat up Olivia and slammed her head into the pool table over and over. But keep in mind, that's not a confirmed story. On Tuesday, October 24th, 2017, when Olivia was 32, she went to the Sportsman's Bar on Main Street in Newtown to play bingo with friends. It's claimed she left the bar between 5 and 7 p.m. She left driving a pickup truck that she had borrowed from a friend, James Hoffenke. James is a white man in his 50s who came to Newtown from California to work in the oil fields. And I will talk a little bit more about the oil fields in a little bit because they do play a part in this case. He befriended Olivia and referred to her as his running buddy. From my understanding, he is not considered a suspect by police, so I don't want people to think that there might have been something nefarious about him, but I could be wrong, but I don't think he's on police's radar. He seemed to be just a good friend to Olivia. I do kind of wonder, did he have a crush on her? But he did befriend her, and he let her borrow his pickup as often as she needed it. This truck was a 2011 Chevy Silverado that was a metallic gray-green color. When Olivia left the bar, she was wearing a black Columbia jacket that had pink lining and light-colored blue jeans. What exactly happened to Olivia after she left the bar that night is still not known to this day. A May 2022 FBI search warrant revealed that on that night, Olivia sent a text message to James that read, quote, "Well, we had a little bonfire. Now we are going mudding. Wish me luck," unquote. Who the "we" she is referring to is still not known, or at least hasn't been revealed to the public. At 10:24 p.m., Olivia sent another text message to James that just read, "Goodbye." That 2022 FBI search warrant also revealed that at 10:37 p.m. that night, Olivia sent a text message to her ex-boyfriend, Adam Bangan, but it wasn't revealed to the public what that text said. At 11:24 p.m., her phone was used to update the cover photo on her Facebook, and she changed it to a picture of who I think are 3 of her children. And just to clarify, when I looked at it on my phone, it says that she changed her photo on October 25th, but that's because I'm in Central Time Zone, and where Olivia lived was Mountain Time Zone. According to that FBI warrant, she changed it at 11:38 p.m., which my time would be after midnight, so that's why my phone says October 25th. At 11:38 p.m., her phone accessed Facebook again. And after that, there was no more activity on Olivia's phone. Olivia kept in regular contact with her friends and family, so when people didn't hear from her, they began to worry. They do think Olivia made it home that night after she left the bar, because that Columbia jacket she had been wearing when she left was found at her home. I also read that her wallet, purse, and cell phone were found at the home, but I'm not sure if that is accurate, at least the part about her cell phone, because she had been accessing it up until 11:38 p.m., or somebody at least was using her phone, so I don't think it would have been found at home unless somebody returned it. If one of you knows the specific details about the cell phone and if it was found at her home, please let me know below. Nothing indicated foul play had occurred in Olivia's home. There was just no sign of Olivia. There was also no sign of that Chevy Silverado she had been driving. But the pickup was picked up on a bank surveillance camera, and it looked like it was driving west. I don't think the exact time of when the truck was seen on the surveillance camera has been released. I know this is typical in a lot of cases, but the people who knew Olivia knew that she did not disappear on her own. The main reason is because she loved her children. She would not abandon them. And Olivia also just loved life. I mean, you cannot find a picture of her not smiling. She just looked like a joyful spirit. She embraced life. She loved adventure. She was not depressed. She didn't have anything to run away from. On Friday, October 27th, Olivia's family reported her missing to tribal police. But tribal police didn't create an official report of it until Monday. The local news couldn't air anything about Olivia being missing until tribal police created an official report of it. So almost a full week went by before it could even get in the news that Olivia was missing. As for the reason the tribal police waited until Monday to file an official report, apparently someone from tribal police told Olivia's father, quote unquote, "This is not the only thing going on with the Fort Berthold Reservation," unquote. A search began for Olivia, but things get complicated when crimes occur on tribal land. There's a lot of jurisdiction issues. Tribes are limited in what they can do due to the 1978 Supreme Court case, Oliphant versus Suquamish Tribe. That ruled that tribes had no power in prosecuting non-Native people for crimes, even if those crimes occur on tribal land. It sounds like in Olivia's case, a lot of agencies were contacted and they were involved. I put quotation marks around that because it doesn't seem like any agency actually put in a lot of effort to try to find Olivia. And that goes for both tribal and non-Native agencies. Olivia's brother, Matthew Lone Bear, has put in so much effort to try to find answers about his sister.
She's just very family oriented, very sociable. You know, she got along with just about everybody.
I want to put a call up for anyone that is available to come help us search.
It's going to be difficult with law enforcement. That's always the common issue between all of them. They don't ever jump in time. They don't put their resources towards it.
He said tribal police didn't even talk to his family until 5 weeks after Olivia went missing. It sounds like the tribal police were thinking, oh, she'll just come home someday. North Dakota Bureau of Criminal Investigation, Game and Fish, and Highway Patrol were contacted along with the Bureau of Indian Affairs. Olivia's family reached out to the FBI for help, but they initially gave a vague answer.
The FBI put out a statement saying, well, it varies between reservation and reservation. It varies from state to state. It's a coin toss. Maybe we will, maybe we won't.
So Olivia's family and friends were basically on their own to try to find out what happened to her. They turned to social media. Matthew moved back onto the reservation and established headquarters where locals gathered and mapped out areas to search. They created a timeline of Olivia's last known actions. They searched areas on foot and with Matthew's drone. Matthew set up a tip line, and they did receive around 400 tips, and he logged every single one of those. Matthew did everything he could think of to try to find his sister. He is such a good example of devotion to a loved one. Newtown, North Dakota is surrounded by a lot of water. The Missouri River runs by it, and a little south of Newtown, it widens into Lake Sakakawea. But it seems like locals refer to the part of the river that is closest to Newtown as Lake Sakakawea too. There's a little inlet that goes almost right up to the edge of town called Sanish Bay. Almost from day one, Olivia's family begged authorities to search the water. And this was October in North Dakota. They had a very short amount of time before the snow would arrive and the water freeze. But no agency would search the water. A month after Olivia went missing, Matthew was still begging for somebody to please search the water. No one would.
What is your family calling for now, Matthew?
We do still need water support. We do need people on the ground, definitely, because the Fort Berthold Reservation is just about 1 million acres. So that's a lot of ground to cover. The more people we can get in before the snow falls and before the lake freezes, you know, we want to get as much done as possible before then.
Now this brings us to a pretty remarkable woman. I don't think everybody is a fan of her. She might be a little controversial, but she has a really strong heart. This woman is Lisa Yellowbird Chase. She is a well-known North Dakota woman who used to be a welder, but now dedicates her life to try to find missing and murdered people. She mostly works with Indigenous cases, but I did see she was involved in finding answers in the case of another missing Newtown person, Christopher Clark, who, as you can tell, is a white man. Lisa joined the search for Olivia in November 2017. In December, the family and Lisa held a press conference to try to get interest in the search. Shortly after the press conference, Lisa and Matthew had a falling out. Matthew has called her a quote-unquote thorn in our side, and there's been accusations of disrespect on both sides, but I'm not sure on the specific details of why they parted ways. For whatever reason, the Lone Bear family didn't want Lisa to help in the search anymore. But Lisa didn't want to give up. I don't think it's in her nature to give up. She is the definition of a dog with a bone when it comes to trying to find missing people. So she kept thinking about Olivia and did what she could on her own.
I'm not no goddess or anything that says, hey, I'm in charge of all the missing and murdered people. No. But if you need to put a face, if someone needs to stand up and be the bad guy to advocate and put the word out and be the one to break those barriers, go ahead. I'll be the bad guy.
Winter arrived and the water still had not been searched. Matthew was told that a search would have to wait until spring. So this poor family had to go the entire winter still not knowing what happened to Olivia. They didn't slow down their efforts in trying to find her, though. Matthew kept being told, as soon as the snow melts, we will search the water. But spring arrived, the snow melted, and no water search was done.
We're told that as soon as the water thaws, they're going to do a 100% water search. And water thawed, nothing happened.
Spring turned to summer and still no water search. How do you even find excuses that make sense at that point? When I listen to Matthew's interviews, when he has talked about this, you can just feel his frustration. And it's very easy to understand why he feels that way. Meanwhile, Lisa Yellowbird Chase had spent the whole winter thinking about Olivia, and she felt that the answers were in the water. In July 2018, she and some of her team went to Newtown with their boat. They started searching the water with sonar. On the night of July 27th, they were searching Sanish Bay when their sonar spotted a rectangular object. They felt it looked like a pickup truck. They alerted local law enforcement, who sent down a diver on July 31st. It did end up being the Chevy Silverado that Olivia had been driving the night she disappeared. It was found about 400 feet from shore and about 20 feet beneath the water. Tragically, Olivia's body was found buckled into the passenger seat.
I knew enough about her from what I heard that there was only one thing that could come between her and her children, and that was death. And that's why I went back the second time to pursue the water, and she was recovered.
Where the pickup was found was less than a mile from Olivia's home. So for all those months, Olivia was right there, but no agency had been willing to help the family find her. And she was right there.
Why wasn't it done until now? Because when they did it, they found her almost immediately.
There's so much red tape it went on, you know, right toward the end here, you know, we had tribal PD and BIA point fingers about who's going to do the water search. And they were chomping at the bit back in January. They said, as soon as the water thaws out, we're going to be on the water. We're going to search the water 100%. But then, you know, fast forward 3 months down the road, and they still had no boats on the water. They just, you know, it just became accountability at that point. And I don't think anybody wants to take accountability for all that that water search. So as far as the family goes, you know, we did what we had to do as far as doing a land search, but we don't have resources and or knowledge to do a water search. So we relied on law enforcement agencies to do this.
Olivia probably did not drive into the water on her own, since she was found in the passenger seat, buckled in.
The United States Attorney's Office for North Dakota released a press release in November 2019, and they said Olivia's autopsy could not determine her cause of death. They didn't see any signs of trauma or any indication of a natural death, and they also didn't see any toxicological causes, so that makes me think no drugs or alcohol. No trauma makes me think, well, she probably wasn't shot or stabbed, and it also makes me think maybe she wasn't strangled, because usually when that happens, I think it's the hyoid bone that's in the center of your neck. Usually that breaks when a person is strangled, or you would think there would be marks on her neck. They also couldn't determine if she drowned. So it really is a mystery of what happened to Olivia.
A funeral for Olivia was held on August 6, 2018.
Honesty of my life, beautiful lady. That's my mother.
On August 9th, a MMIW walk was held for her.
I wanted to do this for a long time since Olivia first went missing. Every day I thought about her. And I couldn't help her.
Eventually, the FBI did get involved in this case. In May 2022, an FBI search warrant was granted for cell phone pings that occurred on the night of October 24th, 2017, around the boat ramp near where the truck was found. I think that's called geofencing. Instead of looking at somebody's phone and figuring out where the phone was, they can look at an area and tell whose phone was in the area during a certain time. It was in this May 2022 search warrant that Olivia's final text messages and the last activity on her phone was released.
As you can see, it's like the law enforcement, the FBI, the tribal police all failed this family. Just for a water search, and she was right there. She was right there. I mean, to me, that's just, it's unacceptable. It's unacceptable. And they should be able to, you know, and I'm wondering, just to bring this into the BK, the Brian realm here, they said just here that phones can be, they can see whose phones are around what area. Now, I wonder if Psy isn't going to get into that with in the Kohlberger case. What phones were around? What phones were inside that house? What phones were outside in the street? I think there's more coming up in the Kohlberger case that's going to blow people's minds, and I think Psy Ray is going to be at the top showing certain things. I think there's going to be some very shocking news. Anyway, this is it's with the indigenous people, it's gone on too long, and it's not the percentage of the indigenous people is 10% higher for indigenous women to end up missing. And that is unacceptable. That is unacceptable. And if you just missing people alone, just missing people alone, because I'm going to cover missing people of all races, but I am going to concentrate a little more on the indigenous side because I am from a reservation and I see how they get shoved behind and not even by their own tribal police. And that's just, it's not acceptable, people. It's not acceptable. And this is a very important subject, a very important subject in this country. I mean, over 200,000 go missing every year. Look up in your own state how many people are missing. It will blow you away. You'll be going, what the hell? And a lot of them, this one, thank God, wasn't trafficked, but she ends, you know, they don't know what happened to her. But a lot of them are being trafficked. There is a trafficking emergency going on in this country, and it needs to be brought to light. And I know Rory's going to be bringing this out. I'm going to be bringing this out. And there's other channels that are going to be bringing this out. And we will share channels that will be helping us with this whole missing thing, because it's always got to me. I've been doing this for years. I've been looking up different states because the missing things always got to me. And it's, you know, when I started to get into the true crime was when Unsolved Mysteries came out. Does anybody right off the bat know who the first guy was before Robert Stack? Before Robert Stack, there was somebody else that did Unsolved Mysteries. Can anybody say it, who it is right now without looking it up? Can anybody tell me who it was? Let me see if anybody comes up with a name real quick. You're not going to believe it. Raymond Burr. Yes. Ironside and Perry Mason. Raymond Burr. But anyway, let's finish up this video here.
Revealed. At the time I'm recording this, it's been almost 7 years since Olivia went missing, and there still have been no names listed as potential suspects. I know I keep saying this, but again, at least not revealed to the public. A major theory in this case, however, is that what happened to Olivia had something to do with the nearby oil fields. There is a rock unit known as the Bakken Formation that encompasses part of North Dakota, Montana, and Canada.
Okay, this is a certain time, a very dangerous, dangerous place. We had a gig lined up in Williston from our agent. And when our agent said, well, you need to pack guns. And I said, what? He said, well, you better bring some guns. It's kind of crazy out there. I said, what the hell? And we decided against it, and we canceled out that gig because it was just really, really crazy out there. And whenever you're talking oil fields, they come from all over the United States. You don't know who's working them.
This area is a major resource for oil. It sounds like oil was discovered in the area in the 1950s, but they didn't have the tools to get the oil out until the 2000s. In 2006, the partial oil field was discovered, which is very close to Newtown. This discovery led to North Dakota's oil boom. Billions and billions of barrels of oil have been recovered from the entire Bakken Formation. Oil companies moved into North Dakota to recover the oil. Some local people were hired, but most of the workforce comes from people from out of state who moved to North Dakota temporarily to work, and then they go back to their home state. The oil companies set up what's known as man camps to house these workers. Oil in North Dakota is kind of a catch-22. It created loads of jobs, so much so that North Dakota had the lowest unemployment rate in the entire country from 2008 to 2014. And it brought in a lot of money. But along with the good, it brought a lot of bad. Crime rates in particular soared. Oil and money and greed are never a good combination, but the creation of these man camps where people from out of state could come to work created a very unique social problem. Men who live in other states come to North Dakota to temporarily work. Maybe they leave behind a wife and children or other kinds of responsibilities. they come to an area where nobody knows them, and some of them kind of think it gives them a free pass.
What happened here? Something happened? Let me, something happened. Let me, there we go.
Pass to do whatever they want, have some fun, and then when the oil job is done, they can go back home and be a responsible member of society again. This is what contributes to the high crime rates that the oil fields brought in. The people most affected by the increase in crime have been Native women. That's already horrible, but then add to that that it's well known that MMIW do not get the same coverage that white women do. So you have men who come to North Dakota and have this mindset that I can do whatever I want and have fun before I have to go back home. And then add to that this mindset of, well, nobody cares about these women, so I really can do whatever I want to them because nobody cares. Crimes against all Native women, not just the ones in North Dakota, are staggering. According to federal government statistics, 84% of Native women experience some kind of violence in their life. 84%. It's a very plausible theory that Olivia might have met an oil field worker in the bar that night. Maybe they made plans to meet up later. Olivia went home, changed her clothes, and then met him somewhere. And then an accident happened and he fled the scene. Maybe it's like a Ted Kennedy situation. You know, maybe Olivia let him drive and they were muddying, but then he lost control and they accidentally went in the water and he was able to get out, but he just left her there. But if Olivia went in the water when she was still alive or at least conscious, you'd think she would have unbuckled herself, and she was found buckled into the car. Unless as the pickup went in the water, maybe she bumped her head and got knocked out and she couldn't unbuckle herself, but I do not think she went in the water conscious. It really does seem like somebody killed her, left her in the passenger seat, started to drive the car into the water, and then they hopped out and the truck kept going into the water. If it wasn't one of the oil field workers, another theory is that it has something to do with her ex-boyfriend and what happened at Ranchman's Steakhouse. Remember that one waitress said that the wife of this ex-boyfriend of Olivia's came in one night and beat up Olivia. So if that is true, the wife obviously is not a fan of Olivia. Maybe she thought her husband and Olivia were still hanging out. If it's true she banged Olivia's head onto the pool table over and over, she obviously has a violent nature. Is it possible she murdered Olivia because she wanted her out of the picture and away from her husband? One of Olivia's last text messages had said, "Well, we had a little bonfire. Now we are going mudding. Wish me luck." She said, "Well," like she was going into something with apprehension. So I kind of wonder, did this woman reach out an olive branch and say, "Hey, I know we've had our differences. Let's get together and hang out and see if we can move past that and become friends." That is a scenario I think you would be apprehensive to go into, especially if it's true that this woman had banged her head against a pool table. I mean, of course, you're not going to be excited to hang out with them. If that is how things went down, you do have to wonder if that was just a ploy by this woman to get Olivia alone so she could kill her and get her out of the picture. The last text message Olivia ever sent, according to that FBI search warrant, was sent to her ex-boyfriend, Adam Bangin. I do not know if that guy is the same ex-boyfriend.
Yeah, my son Julian was oil rig inspector in Oklahoma for a couple of years there, back probably. He was pretty young to be an inspector. Must have been like 12 years ago, something like that. And they drink hard. Yes, they do. Yes, they do.
Boyfriend who has the wife who supposedly beat up Olivia. They could very well be different people.
So I don't think that Adam is the husband of the wife who beat up Olivia, allegedly. His Facebook says he's single. I did see a lot of divorce records for people with his same last name, but none for him. So I don't think he's ever been married. I could be wrong, but I don't think Adam is the husband of the woman who was upset with Olivia.
We do not know what that last text message said. it's possible to stay friends with an ex. So maybe she was reaching out to tell him goodbye. You know, she texted James, the guy who owned the pickup. She texted him goodbye. There's valid reasoning that police do not reveal everything they know because that could really ruin a case. Unsolved cases can be so frustrating because your mind just fills in the blanks of all these possibilities. Think about how it is for that family.
Boy, doesn't that ring true? That rings true in the Brian case and with the, you know, like the ARAs and the Ombre thing going on now. I hope that kind of comes to an end and I hope they work out something, but yeah, it's an awful thing. And there is the oil rig. I'm not getting down on everybody, of course, because my son was also working. But you think of these oil rig people, you know, if they do something, then they go home to their families when they're done. You know what I mean? I mean, it's almost too easy for them. And out in Williston, North Dakota, I'm telling you, that place was rugged. During that time, this one town we went through, one of my girlfriends was a truck driver out there. She drove water, these big things, she was a semi driver, a big semi truck full of water to all these oil rig places. And we stopped at this one town, which the population was only 900, and they had a Senex. You know what a Senex store is, right? Gas station. It was the busiest Senex store in the United States in a town of 900 people. We went in there, and I'll tell you what, that place was crazy, crazy, crazy busy. That whole area was just swamped. So I don't know if they'll ever find out what truly happened to that beautiful native girl. And it really affects me because I don't know, this case just got to me. I watched it today and it just got to me, so I thought I would share it. This stuff needs to get out there. That's pretty much it for the video there. The name of that, again, is Monsters of the Midwest. She's got a good channel, but, you know, you look at it, and she's got 4,000 subscribers, 4,036 subscribers, and she only got 823 views on this. And just in comparison, I started out with 240 people in here, and it's down to 168. People need to start listening to this. And I appreciate every one of you being here, but people need to start listening to what's going on in the United States with missing people, and especially on the indigenous side. It's very important what's going on because there is trafficking going on right under our noses. Right under our noses. And they're being shipped to places like China and Russia. And I'm telling you, it's that crazy. And especially around places where there the trafficking around places that are close to ports. Now, I'm close to a major port, believe it or not. Being in Minnesota, I'm by a major port. I'm 2 hours away from a major port in Duluth, Minnesota. And a former singer of mine, her son, worked on those ships. And you know what he told his mom? He said, "Mom," he said, the ships, of course, they get inspected, right? And they have to hand over the blueprints to these ships. He said, "The blueprints aren't right, Mom." He said, "There's hidden rooms. There's rooms." Because he worked on those ships. He knew those ships. He said, "Those blueprints aren't right. There's hidden rooms in those ships." This shit is going on right under our noses, people. Right under our noses. Always keep your eye. In nowadays world, it isn't like it used to be. We need to keep our eyes and our ears peeled at all times, especially when you see children or if a woman is in trouble, or you know what? Even boys. They're trafficking boys or trafficking girls or trafficking. And it's getting bigger and bigger. And it's controlled by billionaires, people. It's controlled by billionaires. And we need to be more mindful of what's going on around us. And that's my show for tonight. And again, like I said, I'm going to share this this video, this band that I know all of them very well. And actually, the bass player is a chief of the Red Lake Nation. It is an indigenous band. I know them all very well. And the singer was a very, very good friend of mine. And he helped me through the murder of my son. I just wish I could have been there for him when his son was taken out. And he couldn't handle it, and he ended up taking his life. Anyway, and his name is Tommy Bucanaga. I love you all. Have a good evening. Until next time, rock and roll.
Moving like right, this next number is off.
Shit.